I'm still alive, so I'm still taping. That's a good thing. Welcome to the video. I'd like to be helpful in the world starting January 1st for an 18-month period or so. We'll see how that goes. I don't want to set any hard goals because I never reached them quite the way I want to. But in this case, you know, I'm really going for it. Now, the question is, do you want somebody, everyone has to ask themselves this question. Do you want someone in the world who can truly just laugh at the whole thing? Just laugh and say, everything's fine, don't worry. Or not? You see, this is the question. This is the question that everyone has to ask themselves. Do you want someone in the world who can apparently afford to laugh at it all? You know, just, wow, how's that possible? And yet they are, they're able to, you see. So, this may be a choice that we make coming up, the new year, 2015, is which way are we going? Because if you decide, you know what, yeah, I do want that, then you are certainly going to get into that mode yourself, and you'll lighten up, and you'll start to laugh, and you'll lighten up. You'll feel the lightening up taking place, just wow. If you don't do that, you want to get down into the deep, you know, grim, no laughter situation, then that's what will happen. So it's a big decision. I go with the laughter. Trying to decide that way. Trying to be helpful that way. Because this is a very fortunate decision to go that way, for sure. As the world gets worse and worse and worse in many ways, seeming to get worse, there is a perspective in that none of it matters at all. None of it matters at all. In fact, everything is just absolutely perfect. And we just laugh at the foolishness of what we tried to separate from reality. Keep in mind that if what we are is all powerful, to perfect freedom, all powerful, okay, all powerful. Now, if we want to change that, have a difference from all powerful, how do we do that? Through disempowerment, through denying that we're all powerful. That's the only way. It is the only way. So we need to keep in mind that we are all powerful. With the understanding that this means we cannot truly disempower ourselves, because God created us as all powerful. We didn't create ourselves, so we're not able to truly disempower ourselves. And if you want to call that means we're not all powerful, then you just have level confusion. It's just a silly whim to engage in level confusion. So we're trying to disempower ourselves in order to prove we're even more powerful than God. How can we be more powerful than all powerful? Through only avenue is disempowerment, that's it. So this is what we've been attempting to do, and this is how we experience it. And we're those who are still very grim about this, and I've got to get, you know, I've got to disempower myself more and more and more and more and more. Well, welcome to the world. Welcome to this world. Great place for that. Ideal circumstances to believe that you're experiencing tremendous disempowerment. As I've said, July of 2016, there should be at that time a crystallizing of a global bureaucracy, of an attitude that says, okay, this is what we want here. This is what we're going to do. This is the future. So a new vision of the future will have crystallized by that time. And it's a vision of tremendous disempowerment. Yeah. And they're working on it frantically, for sure. But there's another vision. and that is that all this attempt to disempower ourselves is just the functioning of our power. That's all that it is. So everything's perfect. Everything's fine. Our power is functioning perfectly. Nothing is wrong. Nothing has to take place. There's nothing we need to do. We don't need to re-empower ourselves. No, we never have strayed one iota from perfect empowerment. No one ever has. And this can be known, but because of our continuity problem, it requires a very wise approach. And this is what I talk about in the continuity problem. How do we truly make the wise approach, the effective approach? And what it is we, in seeing, oh yes, this is so, we say, wait a minute, okay. But I'm not going to just jump into it. I'm going to say, wait, I'm going to intentionally not get it, so that I can realize that I've been in control of not getting it all along. We cannot make any leap at all until we realize that we've been in power of not leaping all along, and there's been absolutely nothing extraneous or external to our power that has had any effect on us all. In fact, there's nothing outside of our power at all. So we've been 100% completely in control of our not jumping, of our attempt to disempower. You see? And once we do that, take that step, and acknowledge this, and accept it, and get over the shock, like, wow, this is such a tremendous shock, wow, then there isn't any leap. It's just a gentle, continuity then is just general, total continuity. Because why? So I'm still in control. I'm just no longer trying to trick myself into thinking that I'm not. That I don't need all the accoutrement of that, all the staging of this world. And what Jesus tells us is that when you reach this stage, and you're ready for this, what you start seeing is you start seeing tinges of light around anything, around everything. Little tinges of light. Beautiful, beautiful light around everything. And there's no difference between the light that is tinging something big or something small, something heavy, something light, something new or something old, something expensive or something inexpensive. There's no difference whatsoever. The light, because everything is made, is an expression of the same light, which is the ever-fresh living light. And in seeing this, when he says, when you see this, for sure, you're very, very close, very near, and excuse me, very near. That came like that. Wow. Didn't catch that one. Maybe I better slow down. You're very near. That's good enough. So again, we have first, we own our not, our quote-unquote, unenlightenment as being complete, it's been completely under our control always. No possibility of it being any otherwise. This is crucial, absolutely crucial. Or otherwise, you'll get stuck. And then try to reify, concretize abstraction. You know, so first, take a step back. You're right there. Okay, now I'm here. Great. Okay, let me just take a step back and just say, okay, I'm consciously aware. I am holding myself back now. I'm under control. This decision to not do it is totally my decision. And do that, and you become aware. And own your power. Otherwise, it'll seem like some huge shift of power, and then you'll start thinking, well, how did I lose my power? And then the wheels will come off. And you'll start again, reifying abstraction. Now when we see that everything is just light, it's all the same light. No matter what appearance is, it's all made of the exact same light that can take on any appearance whatsoever. We begin to get used to that. And that's, then we're in a different scenario, different ballgame. But before we get in that ballgame, let's consciously not get in that ballgame. And then say, okay, no, wait a minute, I'm going to stop right here. And just for a moment or two, and accept the fact that it's always been my decision. This has always been my decision. This is totally crucial. This is a step which I feel many don't have in their tool bags so much. This is causes a problem. So you stop short, you stop all your thoughts, stop all your thinking, because it's not about thinking at all at this point. It's about power, your power. Acknowledging your power. And your power does not lie in thinking or thoughts at all. Your power lies in your will, spiritual will, the will to experience. So you're stopping. I will stop here. If this is my will, spiritual will, that I'm going to stop right here. And I'm not going to go into enlightenment. And I'm going to be aware that I'm intentionally not allowing myself to go into enlightenment. And then I'm realizing I've always been doing this. This is what I've been doing all along. Is saying, no, I'm not going to allow myself. So it's my choice. It's a choice that I make. Nothing is making the choice for me. Nothing is holding me back. It's all 100% my choice. And then feel good, celebrate your power of being able to do that. Of continuing to view light as not light. The light is not light. As if there's some determinate difference among what we call forms or process. And as if that has something to do with the nature of light, differentiating the nature of light, which it is not. As far as the world's concerned, certainly we want to make a decision soon, because the world is going in a certain direction very quickly. And good luck with that, if you go along with that, good luck. But we know we're headed towards this global control mechanism, surveillance, everyone under surveillance through centralized bureaucracy, and on and on and on and on. It's been going in that direction, for so long. And if people felt they had a choice, they certainly wouldn't choose this. So it's those who go into that feel that it's happening to them. They don't see it as this is something that they're choosing, and therefore it's hard for them to see an alternative. They feel it's just something they're working out of what's going on in a collective way, and that really they can be angry at it, get upset with it, try to stop it and all this, but they're not at the level of choice, the level of will. as Jesus said, you cannot make a meaningful choice between two options if you're not clear about the options. And so how can we choose between a dream of disempowerment and empowerment? How can we choose between a dream of disempowerment and acknowledging our power if we don't realize that we chose, in the first place, we chose the dream of disempowerment, and that we have an actual choice here? It's our choice. This dream was not superimposed upon us, was not pushed upon us by any external force at all. So first we have to realize we do have a choice. It is our choice before we can make a meaningful choice. So I can choose this, or I can choose that. Both are entirely my choice. Whichever one I choose is entirely my choice. And since we've already been choosing the dream of disempowerment, we have to acknowledge that this has been, up to this point, this has been my choice. And then the power of choice begins to take on meaning now. So, for example, several months ago, maybe it's been as much as three now, I had this experience of going in, abiding in the non-dual, and non-duality. And then I saw that I was attracted to something that was a little, I felt like maybe I might need to respond, and I started feeling like I might struggle with it. And then right away I said, no, instead of that, I'm going to decide to consciously choose the dualistic state again. Consciously, so I consciously backed away and didn't struggle. I just said, okay, I'm choosing this. So that's a very wise choice. It's been very productive. Instead of struggling, and trying to, which would have got me into thinking this way, I wasn't thinking at all. I was just aware that I made this choice. That's all. And I accepted it. See, I said, okay, I feel this is the guidance of the Holy Spirit. This is wisdom. I will do it this way. Fine. So just stay calm, stay poised. No struggle, no upset, nothing. So my thinking has remained very muted through all. Very little thinking arises. I did not engage it. Do not struggle with the struggle. If you see the struggle, just say, consciously say, okay, I choose to, you know, back away from the struggle, or something like that. For right now, I'm not going to engage in the struggle. It's a very interesting time we live in. Extraordinary changeover to a different way of structuring a world. That is for sure. And many of us feel, you know what? Don't really need that. I think we'll just sidestep this. Very aggressive agenda. But in order to do that, we have to remember to laugh. We have to remember, somehow, we have to feel that it's all okay. It's all okay. All okay. Everything is okay. There's no way we can disempower ourselves. So if some want to go keep on with this trip of disempowerment, that's fine. It doesn't bother us at all. We know they cannot disempower themselves at all. And because since we're all one, we're certainly very fearful that somehow someone will disempower themselves, and that will end up, that will disempower all of us. So we're kind of concerned about that, a little bit concerned. But if you get those who reassure us with their laughter and the real, and say, everything's perfect, don't worry, then we'll lighten up and say, okay, that's fine. Let them do what they want to do. That's fine. Let them go. Let them go. Let them go down the rabbit hole. That's okay. They can't disempower themselves. It's impossible. So it all seems funny then. You know, it lightens everything up. So very soon, soon and very soon, we are going to see the Lord. Soon and very soon, the King. Well, what is the King? King is this realization that no one can disempower. Spirit cannot disempower itself, no matter what it tries to do. And so the fear is gone, really. This concern. We're liberated from that concern. Ultimately, our problem is a continuity problem, because we fear being liberated. We're not used to it. That is always in play. You have to be very cognizant of that. But it is also, it is true that we do have this dread, like, whoa, wait a minute, what happens if disempowerment, someone manages that? You know, I gotta go down and make sure they don't do it. And so we get engaged in this world. We think that, look at this world, and we say, wow, they're so disempowered. You know, and they're working on even greater disempowerment. And we think, I got to come down here and help out and try to say, stop, don't do anymore, you know. But this is not true. It's totally impossible for spirit to disempower itself, and even in the slightest bit. So there's absolutely no concern with that at all. And this is what the ones that come here and lighten our load and lift us up, this is what they're... presence is all about. Don't worry, nothing to worry about. For example, again, Sri Sri Anandamayi, in all the problems in the 20th century, they would say, hey, look at all this terrible disempowerment going on. Countries attacking others, invading, slaughtering, you know, hideous stuff going on, famines are destroying your country and people, horrible disempowerment. Can you do something to help this awful disempowerment that's going on? And she said, what? Everything's perfect. There's no disempowerment going on at all. And truly, this was not just a clever response. This is actually the awareness of this. It's a difference. Nothing needs to be done whatsoever. Everything is perfect. We cannot disempower ourselves. So, we do have a choice. Which direction do you want to go to? Do you want to go towards the realization that we cannot disempower ourselves? Or do you want to keep on with the belief that we can disempower ourselves? That is essentially the choice that we have to make. And that's it. It's way, way more profound than what we've been led to believe. Because we've been led to believe that we are capable of disempowering ourselves, but we can prevent it. That's dualism, okay? And we need to do good works and make sure that we prevent anyone from being disempowered, and that will get us into heaven like that. But the real truth is that all this attempt to disempower ourselves, the use of bodies, is an attempt to have greater power than all power. It's an attempt to have greater power than all power. It's an attempt to be greater than God. And that is why they're suffering. That is why they do. And, you know, people don't like to have their suffering, the root of their suffering, taken away from, actually. Say, no. That's why sometimes you can heal and it comes back, like that. is an expression of look, I'm disempowering myself. And of course, we need bodies that they have these bodies that can seem to be disempowered as a symbol of disempowerment, really. Bodies are a symbol of disempowerment. But everything that's happening is our own choice, our own attempts, and are ultimately entirely futile, or just they're futile right now, completely futile, always. And yet those who want this disempowerment, they have no choice but to live in the quote-unquote world with bodies and sicknesses and troubles and everything, because this is witnessing to what disempowerment, what they want. How can they live in the death-free realms of perfection? Because there's no evidence of disempowerment there. There's not even symbolization of disempowerment. There's no symbolization of disempowerment. All of this world is just symbolic, actually. It's just a symbol of disempowerment. That's what we're using it for. Now, we can see it differently, of course. While we're here, we can see it all as there's no disempowerment taking place whatsoever. It's all perfect. Just the play of light, just the appearance of light. Light cannot disempower itself. In no way. And if light cannot disempower itself, how can we be disempowered? Because light is our servant, actually. And it does whatever we ask it to do. So if our servant is not disempowered, how can we be? See, how can we be disempowered if light is not disempowered? Very important. So seeing light around everything is you're starting to see, oh, the light really isn't disempowered. It's not trapped in any form. Form has, none of these forms, quote unquote forms, has changed the light at all. In fact, I see the light's the same around everything. So all the supposed differentiation of light is not real differentiation at all. All the supposed determinism is not determinism at all. The light is completely still, it's what it is. The isness of the light is untouched by all this. So our servant is still completely perfect. And therefore, how can we claim that we're disempowered? It's not possible. So the willingness to realize that we cannot disempower ourselves leads to then vision of light, vision, ultimately vision of oneness. First, we have to recognize that it's our choice to be disempowered. We try to try and be disempowered. We've been choosing to do that. So we have to become conscious of that. It's not like we're escaping some demiurge or some Luciferian plot or some, you know, it's not like the darkness, you know, the Manichaean, Gnostic Manichaean, Zoroastrian, dualistic, you know, this horrible force that's trying to destroy God and we finally escape from it, you know. It's not that at all. That's completely dualistic. What we would say is it's not dualistic at all. It's entirely simply my choice, what I chose to experience. It's been my will to experience this, 100%. So everything that's happened, I've chosen to have it happen. It's not even happened to me, but I've chose to experience it. There's nothing that happened to me. There's never been anything that happens to anyone. That's why I say there's no circumstances, there's no situations, there are no happenings whatsoever. So first we have to realize that. Before the vision of light will dawn upon us. When the vision of light does dawn upon us, just again say, okay, and just don't react. Don't make anything of it. Because again, it's not at all surprising based on where you're at now. See, this is where I live, so why should I be surprised? It's like you have electricity in your house and you flick a switch and everything, the whole light turns on. Whereas if you lived in a place with no electricity, it doesn't happen that way. So if you move to a house that has electricity and you flick the light switches on, bam, 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 it's all lit up. You say, wow, this is amazing. But if you live in such a house, you become completely used to it. You don't even think about it. So you just say, oh yeah, this is my house now. This is my house. And don't think about it. Don't think about it. Just experience it. Don't think about it. And first experience it in a continuity way. In a consciously saying, hey, I need to get used to this. That's all. So don't get into your mind, into your thinking, evaluating, judging, any of that. Just say, this is what is, this is what is, it is what it is here, and this is where I am at now, this is where I'm at, this is where I live, this is where I live, that's it. Jesus refers to the vision of light and all this is a healed mind, healed perception, actually. Healed perception is a term we can use, healed perception. Ultimately, what we are experiencing ultimately is doesn't even use perception at all, not even the slightest bit. But because we've in our attempt to disempower ourselves, we've used perception, we've imagined perception. So the intermediate step is healed perception, and that's where we're heading, this intermediate step of healed perception. So you just say, okay, this is part of healed perception, that's all. Just normalize it for yourself. I haven't been watching the news. I stopped watching the news quite some time ago. I made a decision. Holy Spirit said, hey, how would it be to not watch the news anymore? And I said, okay, let's give it a try. So I don't click on internet news. Occasionally I bring the newspaper and I might look at the headlines, but most of the time not. Just maybe I'll look at the sports is all I do. Just that's it. Don't watch television news. Don't watch internet news. Don't watch the news at all. So I'm really not up to date on what's taking place at all, but it's through all the people in the world in various ways that somehow it seeps into you a little bit. You know, people mention things, or there's blah, 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 and so I miss the whole rigmarole that's taking place in the U.S. and is bypassed it entirely, you know. This is one example of bypassing the world. It's not because it's all okay. No one can disempower themselves. It's impossible. Everything's perfect. Everything's fine. But of course, everybody's screaming about disempowerment, and there's so much hostility and anger and fire and whatever. It's just like this. You know, the whole country's on out caught up in, you know. It's just, you see how the world and the country, this world, how it gets caught up in this, and see how you can completely bypass it. Spent my time deeping like this, going towards the vision of light. So imagine what it would be to bypass the world, the future of this world, just to bypass it. How you would come to the vision of light, the vision of oneness, healed perception, even go be, and then eventually even drop healed perception. You would be a savior, like a bodhisattva, whatever you want to say, a Buddha. You know, this is what will happen. Not a bad deal, is it? Or you can be watching the news and say, oh my God, isn't this terrible? Oh my God, what are we going to do? You know, and be caught up. Oh yeah, we must do this. We must do that. And this, you know, the frenzy of the world, which some may think is a lot of fun. Seems fun for a while, and then you decide you want to do something else, and oops, I have a continuity fear, I'm confused. But just imagine sidestepping the future of this world without even paying attention to it at all. Don't need to. There's nothing that anyone can do to disempower anyone. Can't disempower themselves. Nobody can disempower themselves. So the whole issue of somebody else doesn't even arise, does it? It's impossible. It can't even arise. Someone did something to... If you can't disempower yourself in the slightest bit, how can someone do something to you? That's admitting there's some external power that is stronger than your power, which is what we believe we are in relation to God. You see, so we're playing that out between ourselves, but actually it's not there, because we're not greater than God. Therefore, all are perfectly empowered, and nobody can do anything to anyone else. It's impossible. That does mean that everything that happens is play acting in this world, including death, including everything. Since nobody can do anything to you, how can you die? You're deciding to die as an expression of your belief in your capability to disempower yourself. Many people talk about Jesus coming to this world and how awesome that was. And did he not just come here to tell us, hey, spirit, you know, you haven't disempowered yourself. Even with these human bodies, you're not disempowered. So he had a body there, and he's showing it, look, whatever happens, there's nothing happening to you. It's all your own choice. And they said, no, that's not true. That when you die, that proves that you've been disempowered. And Jesus said, okay, watch this. So died on the cross, rose from the grave, says, how do you like me now? There's no disempowerment. I didn't lose my disempowerment. Having the body die was my choice, and now I'm choosing to have the body rise from the dead, not be dead. That's my choice. Death does not disempower you at all. You cannot be disempowered. So what worry is there that something's going to happen to somebody? Nothing can happen. That's why we say there's nothing happening at all. Nothing ever happened. This is a phrase, I think. But a fact, nothing has ever happened. nothing ever will happen. Nothing will ever happen. So why do we need to be concerned? If the boys down the street want to put on a little street play, let them put on a little street play. Why do you need to concern yourself with it? Nothing's going to happen. I hear they put up lemonade stands. It's very popular. Okay, that's fine. Why worry about it? Definitely building up this, you know, intensity, no question, which is what we try to do. Covering a lot of territory here. And so although it may seem easy because we're using words, the words are only pointing towards an experiencing. So what we're doing, we're thinning out the resistance. We're evaporating the continuity resistance, continuity fear resistance. And so, of course, this should get us to begin to be kind of jittery about it. Less and less and less and less resistance. At some point we say, wow, I feel like I'm getting really close, and then, you know, we get a little bit of the jitters. It's very important to have the spiritual discernment and be able to put the brakes on instantly, at any moment. Do not be carried away by any intoxication. Very important. It's an attempt to simply bully your way past the continuity fear, and it'll have severe repercussions that you may not even understand clearly. You know, very difficult to discern. So, respect the continuity fear, respect the break, use the break, realize I'm now breaking. Nothing is causing me to break, I'm the one who is breaking. See, I'm in control, I'm choosing this, I'm the one, so I am breaking. There's no, nature is not causing me to break, nothing is causing me to break, I am breaking. Light is again, perfectly, is perfect and perfectly responsive. There's nothing wrong with light at all. So it's a perfect servant. So why do we need to talk about causation? How come light serves us perfectly? Where's the causation? Why do we need to think about causation? There's no need to think about causation. If there's only just one total causation without a second, why do we even need to conceptualize and say causation, right? Why do we need to even think about it? What's the point? So first we have to recognize that the light is a perfect servant and thank light for the darkness. Thank you, light, for the darkness, really. Thank you so much, light, for the darkness and making everything seem dead and dreary and dreadful. Thank you so much. And acknowledge the light. What a great and faithful servant you have been. And not just intellectually, but actually, you know, feel it. All praise to the light. All praise to this. Don't reify the abstraction of a perfect servant into thinking that darkness is terrible. There's some terrible, you know, anti-God force that is trying to just drag us all down and catch our souls down into darkness and on and on. No, that won't get it done. Say thank you, light, for appearing to be so dark and dreadful. Because truly you are a good and faithful servant, and there's no rebellion in you whatsoever. The truth is, there's never been a rebellion. There's never been a rebellion. We're the ones who chose to make it seem like there was a rebellion, but their light has never rebelled against us. And if it hasn't, it's always been our perfect servant. Where's the rebellion? There's no rebellion at all. There's no rebellion against God. So say, thank you, light, for making it seem like there was a rebellion. So we had a, you know, what a faithful servant. Thank you for all the darkness and despair and death and disease and everything. Thank the light for that, because it was simply being absolutely faithful to what you asked, as it always is. And then that reestablishes your faith and trust in the light, which really reaffirms your power, because the light is your power. The faithfulness of the light and the nature of light is our power. It is our power. So we can, if light cannot be disempowered, we cannot. If light can't disempower itself, we can never be disempowered. It's not possible. So again, here we are with this wonderful remedy of first acknowledging, thanking the light. Thank you for all this, horrible movie I've been watching, scaring the daylights out of me. Believing that somehow, light, you've been disempowered. What a great job you did to scare me. Scary movie. Thank you so much. You might even say this is the key that opens the door. And of course, dualistic mindset will say, wow, you can't do that. That'll empower the darkness. as if we're trying to disempower. We have capability of, we need to disempower the darkness. But if everything is just the light, if we're trying to disempower something, isn't that an attempt to disempower what we are? Disempower ourselves? Of course it is. We don't need to empower anything or disempower anything. We only need to accept everything as it is right this moment, realizing this is all a dance of total empowerment. There's nothing but empowerment. We don't have any condition other than total empowerment. There isn't any other condition. So it's not even a condition. It just is. Reality is not a condition. It just is. Keep in mind that the way we feel right now has absolutely nothing to do with the way that we have felt before, nothing to do with the way we feel after. It's totally based on our choice this instant. Everything is always our choice this instant. So we're actually not bound to anything. We're not bound to any so-called condition or feeling or experiencing, other than reality, the inherent feeling of reality, the inherent greatness of reality, which is inherently blissful, in the blissful freedom, unbound freedom, and empowerment, the feeling, natural feeling of reality. We are certainly bound to that, but it's not a binding, because it is what we are. In other words, you might say we're bound to our perfect freedom. We're bound to our perfection. But that's a contradiction in terms. Bound to our freedom, you see. And language makes this seem like it's a contradiction, but it's not. Certainly, when you start seeing the light around everything, you will realize that there's no disempowerment taking place. Wait a minute. It will start seeping in, you know, and recognition will start seeping in. And we'll see, hey, the light is not being disempowered by the dance of a supposed form. Nothing's happening to the light. And then you will be an enlightened one. One that is enlightened, one that is seeing the light of perfect empowerment. The light of seeing the light of a perfect servant. And then we don't need to do a lot of thinking and judging and discerning as far as differences of faithfulness of the light. This form shows the light is this faithful, and this form shows it's less faithful. This form indicates it's more faithful here. None of that. See, that all comes to an end. All comes to an end. And of course, the dualism is afraid of that because they said, oh, wait a minute, how are you going to discern which is the faithful light and which is the unfaithful light? Because the idea of dualism is somehow we're gathering together all the faithful light, all the light that's remained faithful to God, to our empowerment. And once we gather it all together, then the unfaithful light will be destroyed, will be thrown into the pit of fiery pit of hell and burn there forever and be annihilated. This is dualism. Yeah, this is totally dualistic. We're not trying to gather the faithful light and discard the unfaithful light. All light is one. Light is totally faithful. There's no such thing as unfaithful light. It's impossible. So there isn't any that type of discernment that needs to be made. The discernment to be made is between non-dual and dualism. You see, the non-dual and dualism, that's the discernment that needs to be made. Not accepting dualism as our basic premise and then making discernments within that false premise. That's not what we need to do. So obviously this world is still caught up in dualism to a very large extent. It's not that difficult, right? I mean, we're seeing it right here. It's not that difficult to see through this situation. We ask the light to pretend to be dead, to pretend to be unfaithful to us, to pretend to be incapable of being faithful, pretended to be, you know, disempowered, light disempowering itself. So of course it's acted that out, presented that to us in a faithful way, but that it hasn't touched its faithfulness at all. It's still the perfect servant, absolutely. But authority to be very gently reminded of this. The healing of our perception is very gentle, very gentle. Gentle with ourselves and patient and gentle with this continuity fear as full stop in the now of the wow as we're practicing, then these steps can take place in a gentle way, and it's we just continue this same mood of repentance, that's all. So yeah, this is just healed perception. That this is what the God's plan is, this healed perception. That's okay, fine. Don't try to make too much of it. This is where I'm at now. This is the neighborhood I live in. It's like you just move, change your neighborhood. Okay, you live in this neighborhood now. Just get used to it. Take a walk. Check out the neighborhood. Just get used to it. Sometimes getting used to a neighborhood is to just simply sit there and get a feel for the pace. Just sit there quietly for a whole day. Just get a feel for what is the pace of this neighborhood. How fast are things going here? How slow are they going? How quiet is it? And just sort of get an overall feel of the whole situation. Try to make a big splash in the neighborhood. Just say, okay, I'm here, so I'll just get used to being here. Now maybe it's a neighborhood where everybody's very humble, modest, and unassuming. And so, you know, you get used to being that way and fit right in. Let's say in a neighborhood where everyone has the vision of light, you know, just, okay, yeah, it's just normal. Everyone has the vision of light, just normal. So you just fit right in, it's easy. So just maintain that feeling. I'm just fitting in to what my neighborhood, just preparing for my neighborhood. I'm going to just fit in there just fine. The neighborhood of those who are, healed perception, no longer trying to disempower themselves, knowing that no spirit can disempower itself. It's impossible. That neighborhood, living in that neighborhood, neighborhood that lets the world go on and do this little dance and to continue dancing what we call the future. Doesn't matter. And at the same time, realizing there may be some pragmatic steps. Pragmatism. The Holy Spirit might suggest something. The Holy Spirit usually says, is like, you get this feeling like, how would it be to maybe How would you like to do something like this? It doesn't necessarily say, this is what I want you to do. You gotta do this. It says, consider this. What do you, how do you look, how do you look at this? What do you, would you like to maybe do something like this? And give it some consideration, and maybe you might want to. Maybe not, but maybe you might want to. How would it be to do this? You sort of have this feeling, like some interest, like, ah, oh, this is interesting. Something came into my mind that just interests me. So there might be some pragmatic steps to in some way to remind the world to laugh. Remind the world to laugh. Nothing is threatened. Nothing real can be threatened. Nothing unreal exists. Nothing real can be disempowered. Nothing unreal exists. Nothing real can be disempowered. Nothing unreal exists. Okay, very powerful. Nothing unreal can be disempowered. Nothing unreal exists. So we're getting close to the new year, we're just, you know, less than a month away now. Coming real soon, 250. So the way it's shaping up is it's either going to be a great year for some, or truly a rather ominous year for others. Depending on how you know what you choose, which way you choose to go. So we just keep on preparing. So we're not far away from being able to be benefited from any presence that shows us the presence of everything's perfect. No need to worry whatsoever. We're not far away from that at all, from being able to benefit from that. But again, something like this that is so profound, we might say, okay, first I'm going to say no to that. So I'm aware that I'm saying definitely no, I don't want to do that, I'm saying no to that. And then once we feel that, yeah, I'm in control, I have power over the no, then I can say, yeah, I also have power over the yes to it, you see. So be centered, make sure we're centered in the realization of our power of choice. And we say, wow, what a great, amazing time with no help here. Hasn't that been great? Really scary. So thank you, Light, for putting on this little play. What a perfect servant. And then we can say, okay, now I'm going to decide, I'm going to have a play of a little bit of help here, a little bit of boost here. And can choose that too. Okay. So I tried to push this far enough so I could really feel, you know, slightly the disturbance, like, wow, this is really heavy stuff we're talking about, and that's good, and that's what we always try to do. And then looking back, we'll look at something we did 6 months ago, it's like, oh, it's a piece of cake. But when we did it, it was like super difficult. Now it's like, oh, no problem, it's easy. So where we're at now, 6 months from now, will seem like, oh, it's just totally easy. No trouble whatsoever. And that is a significant progress. And that is it for this video.